APR that you can just go add it on the lathe, but you can still chip it out pretty good on the lathe.
Now, are you selling these?
No, I'm giving these away. It's kind of a thank you to all the folks here that I've learned from. This my adventure to learning pinpoint casting. So I figured I could bring some here. These are, my daughter actually did that one.
Yeah, I think she's better at it than you are.
Yeah, I agree.
Thank you for this. I appreciate it.
Excuse me, Fred.
Yep.
Make sure you reverse paint it, because that's it's pretty transparent. That was my very first attempt. There's one to Vina made the other day.
Boy, that is pretty.
Yeah.
That is really.
And that's got some worthless wood and these two. And there's purple with a little bit of silver.
That, did you do that with you had to do that with pressure pot?
Yes. Yeah. Yep.
Did you do any stuff?
No, I don't have a setup for that yet, but I'm going to.
Clayton was talking about he wanted to set that. He was wanting to know if he could tap the wood. They said he could tap the wood.
Make you one of those blue light ones. Let him try that.
I don't know.
But I ain't want to do wood. That won't be the
well,
same.
Well, I told him, I said, acrylic doesn't tap good. It doesn't put threads good, but from what I understand, the blue light does.
Yeah. You know, that's what I've heard to use.
Put threads in poly? I think it's more of a, it got started at a different level from somebody that was selling a lot of aluminum.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
I'm starting out the casting. I bought me a pressure pot.
That's a different pen this time, though.
I get it up to about 35 pounds, and it wants to leak, and I'll tighten those down.
I got to get a pot,
I guess. All right, I'm going to do a little bit of stabilizing.
I've done some of that.
Have you?
Actually, on this blank, I stabilized these pieces of wood before I put them in here. Mm-hmm. I dried them. And put them in cactus juice, I stabilized them, and put them in here. I just did this couple days. I think that's going to turn really interesting.
Yeah.
I think that's the other one we need.
Is that the one with the wood chips in it?
Yeah.
You got the twig?
That's cool. I got some chocoa cactus.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's pretty cool looking stuff.
And I made a duck call out of it, and it came out looking really neat. And I was eating dye that stuff. So I'll put some dye in it. So I've got some dyed red, and I've got some of it dyed green. This is dyed green, I believe. Give it a little tease.
Do you think anybody wants some of that rosewood? Yeah. My friend brought that and gave it to me. I was going to cut it in half if someone wanted some.
I love that piece of rosewood.
Let's find a way to cut it into as many pieces as somebody wants. I'd like to wind up with
I don't want to use Bob's saw, but.
Well, no, I don't either. But I want to wind up with a foot or so.
Well, let's get him out here and cut it on the bandsaw for us, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'd like that.
Yeah,
I'd like to wind up with a foot of it.
Yeah.
That'd make some pretty pins.
Yeah, he brought it to share today, so.
Okay.
$3 or $2. Anybody can guess the price of that pen?
Do you need the number to that right here?
Anything left, I get anything that's left, I'm okay.
Yeah, this is the
It's different than
high street shovel.
No one go ahead and slow it down.
If he's been acrylic, then you're good.
I want about a foot of it. My friend brought it to share.
Okay.
And he gave it to me before he left. And I said,
let's cut him his foot first.
I just want like enough to make.
How much? You want a foot?
Roughly a foot, yeah. And they can split the rest of it however they want it.
Oh, I'll cut it into pen blank sizes. And
that was from this. That was from Steve Staples that left.
I'll just take a piece.
Steve Staples left that for us. Was it a woman like
it? Thank you.
Or did you come with
rosewood?
I'm not allergic to that.
There is some rosewood.
There's two left.
This is a woman like?
That's a loom light. All this stuff's a loom light.
Is it thread better?
It threads 10,000 times better.
Well, I mean, they're sealed.
Yeah. It's actually harder, but it's more flexible. That makes sense.
One kind of thread.
What are you using?
Capitan.
Just a
capitan.
We're
going to
talk about that in just a minute.
But.
I'm missing a hat.
I turned it. Was it Brazilian rosewood?
Yeah. Somebody didn't have a pen, so they won the hat.
Granada or
something.
Yeah. Is it not in there, Ken?
But I'm just allergic to that. Now I can turn other rosewoods, but not that one does.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
Yeah.
We haven't had trouble with the hospital yet, but you got to watch out even for walnut.
Oh, yeah, the walnut doesn't seem to bother me. I've turned most of that. And that's the only rosewood I found that breaks me out, but that one sure does.
And I don't even get poison ivy, so I haven't been allergic to any of the woods that I've worked with yet.
Yeah.
That's like the
worst thing I ever turned. I don't
know
poison ivy,
someone
gets
one.
Oh.
That's tough to burn your throat.
Y'all come which will? Oh, I've done that. Yeah, I don't like the smell. But
no, it's always burnt hair.
Always turn my vacuum in.
Last time
I had when I do deer antlers, I can't stand the smell. Alligator jawbones.
I've got a lot of hair. I've never done that. I've got, we get around to it.
I've got everything set up. I made a fix it one time. Cedar and a foot.
Well, if it works as good as that guy in the wet goes, then you're good.
Just stuck down there in some water.
Most of that.
That's a good idea.
Are you that?
I will just see if it works. I tried to put it on there one time.
Put some sand on the bottom with a couple of rocks.
And
the hose that goes to the pipe, this just came out. And it runs through the pipe. I'm going, oh, wait a minute. So now I got some Loctite on the threads on the pipe, and we'll see how it.
Yeah, that's strange.
It is.
That'd be scary.
If we continue to.
Brady, I thought you were gonna put that ring on the straight table.
I couldn't hardly do that, huh?
I was watching for it.
This is my little one. You should see my big one.
You keep telling me that.
My big one, I can't wear anymore. I had to have this one enlarged. This cheap silver shrinks when you have it for a long time.
Yeah, you've had it too long.
Yeah. But I do have one that's got a stone bigger than this, and the red stone is about 2 or 3 times that big. I used to wear it for summer camps. Yeah, I hold the microphone up there in that big old ring and just, you know, all the kids.
That's good.
That was my head thumping.
Definitely get their attention.
Yeah, but I can't wear it anymore. I'm gonna take it to the same fellow that did this one and have it enlarged. It's a little different than this. This is a cord, and that one's, this one is fashioned by hand. But that one is a cast. It's cast at 2 halves and going together. So I'm not sure what that means in terms of getting it enlarged, what it would look like.
I wouldn't expect it to make much difference.
Well, it won't, except the part that he puts in to expand it is not going to have the same seam in it that the rest of the thing does. You could easily tell it's been enlarged.
I'll be able to sand it out and smooth.
But, you know, and I kept thinking, well, I think they ruined the value of the ring. The other day I thought, you know, you're nearly 71. Who cares if it ruins the value of the ring? You know?
Better than getting your finger sized.
Let my kids worry about whether it's worth anything or not.
Or get your finger size.
Yeah. It looks like a camera that's on.
It is. We're being filmed. There's sound on that thing, too.
I'm going to get it over to the fruit box. I'm sorry. I'll go ahead.
I put one of those on my train in the backyard.
Oh, did you?
So I go through the bridges and
look at it on the see his setup in his backyard. He lives over.
And you need to put that on YouTube.
And he's got this model train set up in his backyard.
It's not much yet. It ain't much yet.
But it's a whole lot more than my model train. So.
You have a model train?
No, you're a train guy. Mine keeps growing. I've got another 120 feet of track.
Really?
Well, in the process of going down since you were there. In fact, I probably got 150 down since you were there.
I think Mike and Janet kept their house. I don't think they sold their house.
No, I think they, because they come back to Arkansas with all the grandkids here. They come back quite often.
You been to the train in Garvin Gardens?
No, I have not been to Garvin Gardens.
You have to do it.
I was looking on site and saw all the pictures of their daffodils and tulips and how gorgeous those things were.
They got golf carts, so you don't
have
to walk
around. That's what they said.
I do the bridges for their railroad.
I don't see a
steel turning
going on over here. What happened?
Don't know.
Did
everybody leave?
I don't know anything about this.
I can
make stuff up about the other.
I'm sitting here waiting for Bob to start.
Well, I got that angle set if anybody wants to try.
It'd just make me want to buy one.
Well, of course it would. Well,
is this yours, Scott?
Yes, please. If anybody just really wants to try it, here's 2 plugs. One looks to be cherry. The other one is black walnut at the bottom, sorry.
Scott, I'm going to put this in my closet. Don't worry about it. I'll remind you.
Who wants to glue it together and finish it?
There you go.
Get a bag, hun, for them.
Oh.
That would help.
Send the gimpy guy from back.
Guess we don't need this.
He needs to get up and move around.
Oh, do you got exercise?
Yeah. He wasn't quite being weight.
All right, who needs a bag for their stuff?
There's a whole bunch of bags right here.
No, I brought bags. You can have mine.
I got tons at home. I need to get rid of it.
Dr. Jean, you kind of love it.
down in old Washington, the ladies down there saying they're making rugs.
But they used to have an aftermarket one that the company made. This is $100 cheaper.
They don't like that one back too.
Yeah, and I almost bought one of the aftermarket. It looked like it came out this about 2 months after I got my load.
Paul, he'll send us 40 blanks and he'll put them in 20 bags. Anybody else in a bag for stuff?
No.
Well, that's not an extension. There's an extension down there. This is a swingle way. You undo it from here and you pull the tail stock back in and lock it down and just swing it out of the way.
Is that a power,
man? It's trying to. It's cheaper than the aftermarket.
Is it really?
Yeah. $100 cheaper.
Really?
Yeah.
That's cheap place.
You're late, but I'll still.
Well, I waited. I said, I'm not.
I'll just wait.
I'm spending
more
time there now than I was.
Well,
I hope to, but. I got to be there for a while. Now, how far do you have to travel? She lives in Melbourne, so it's about
an
hour from. Yeah, you can get that.
I've never seen her on eBay.
That was only.
But I'm sorry, she's not.
You got any holes or voids or anything? They put a little bit of everything in.
I don't sell.
Some people fill it with brass.
I used to go to the flea market.
It's a real fine brass.
I think that's our first thing.
Yeah,
because I told you
about voids. Yeah.
Holes and blanks.
Like inlays.
Sure.
Anything.
Is that something like a cast? I can put in something in cast.
It'll sink.
We can do that too.
Oh, it's heavy. It's heavy.
Well, I mean, it's just brass shaving.
Oh, it is.
Doesn't look like it.
Sure, that's not gold dust.
I mean, it's gold dust. That's what it is. And I'll take $20 a bag for it.
That's a deal.
Looks like gold.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Now that's got my own.
It looks like it's going that way.
Oh, okay.
So it will run out.
Now, Janice Lynn is going to be in some
hershey. I think I got some.
You're welcome to it. That's what they said. This probably was wrong. I hadn't thought about it. I had old things.
Well,
There's a guy that I just posted on IAP that he uses CA and he mixes mica in his CA and he has different colors and he uses it to fill voids with. That's a good idea.
That's kind of like his coffee ground.
Yeah, he is permanent. I mean, he leaves it in the CA tube. He has colored CA tubes and he has to shake it up. Yeah, because it sells. And
he just got it all pre-mixed in his CA.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're going to make your hair stop
growing. I've been sniffing.
That's a good idea. Right.
I'm surprised it doesn't make the glue harden.
That's what I thought.
You know, it acts as an accelerant.
I thought the same thing. I thought, Okay, y'all ready for kitless?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. What's the first thing that everybody thinks of when they want to think about going kitless?
Too expensive.
No, forget that. What's the second thing you
cut and thread?
Tapping. Cut and thread.
Where do you start? What do you buy? What tap do you buy? What do you need? Isn't that what everybody?
They say triple start, but they tell me you don't have to go with triple start.
I don't go with triple start. I have triple start because I've been, nobody told me that before. Unless you're making them to sell, forget about triple start until you're ready for it. One, it's four times as much, or five times as much for triple start tap and die as for tap and die. Who wants to spend $120 if you can get it for $15 or $20 or whatever? Mm-hmm. You know? And until you get good at it and you're selling them and you want the advantage of triple start. Everybody know what triple start is?
No.
Yeah.
Triple start is when you, on a nut and bolt, you have one place that starts. Mm-hmm. Okay? And one revolution equals so much distance. On a triple start, there's three places to start. And it goes three times as fast. So you, instead of taking four turns to take a top off a pin, it's like one and a half turns.
Right.
That's what it is. That's very simple.
Convenience.
Okay, so forget about triple start. But you do need some tools to start with. I didn't hear that.
No, I said I...
You're going to tell jokes. I got to make them loud so I can
hear. She was at the shop the other day. I told her one thing that pin turners don't have is patience. And that's the reason you need a three start. Because you don't have, you don't want to... take all that time to do those.
Pin turners are the most, they have no time at all, so they buy accelerator for instant blue.
Yeah.
It's not fast enough. Okay, the first thing I recommend you get, even if you don't even want to go kitless, is a collet chuck. Mm-hmm. I cannot live without my collet chuck. Everybody says, what do you use it for? I don't know what I don't use it for. I really don't. I use it all the time. And I think the first kitless pin, I got these set of collets, which is from 3 to 20. I think I have 12 of them out for my first kitless pin. You don't need that many, but that's what I have out. So you're going to need a set of collets to go with your collet chuck. Now, most of them have a kit that gives you like 5 collets or 6, I'm not sure. You can do that, but you've got to make sure everything falls in that collet range. And with this, from 3 to 20, everything's covered. There's no gap. So whatever you turn it around to, it'll fit as long as it's under 20 or over 3.
And from 800 watt on even?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. 800 watts we got on there.
Can you send us that link?
Sure.
Is that the link you just sent us? You can send us a link on college.
Well, no, there's somebody who has college for sale.
Right.
Oh, yes. I said that was a good deal, and it was gone in like 30 seconds.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
What's that set? What
did
that set run?
Set runs about... It's kind of like buying gold. Yes. It goes up and down. About 60 bucks.
Yeah, 60. 60 to 80. And if you will check, you'll have the same set on eBay at three different prices.
Yes.
So you want to search through that to find this.
Yeah, make sure you go from high to low, including shipping. Because sometimes they'll sell them for $49.95 with $49.95 shipping.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you
have to
be careful.
Yeah,
you know if the collets are interchangeable, like with the Beale set?
They are interchangeable bills. That's an ER32 collet.
Yeah.
They have, there's lots of ERs, 25, 32, 40, 50.
Does it say that on the collet itself?
Let's get one out and see.
I have it.
Well, it says it on the box.
Yeah.
Because I've got the PSI.
Is that the adapter?
I've got one.
That's the adapter for the set, right? That's not the one that would screw on a 1x8.
This will screw on one by, no, this was 1.25x6.
1.25x, yeah.
I bought it for this lathe. I had one and I sold it because it was for a smaller lathe. They come in different spindle sizes. So depending upon, you need to know your spindle size of your lathe. Usually it's a 1x8 or 1.25x6. One of the two.
Mine's 1.25x8.
Right. 1.25x8? Is that, okay, I'm sorry, 1.25x8. Is that right? I'll just six. Don't listen to me.
Can you an adapter to go from?
Yes,
you can. You're going to get some.
As long as it runs through,
you're going to get some run out. Just remember that.
I looked off.
You have two legs, different sizes?
Three.
Okay. Well, I don't tell you.
Might be cheaper to buy another.
It might be cheaper to buy another. Well, actually, the collet's not that bad. I mean, this was, I think I bought it on sale for $60-something, because I already had these, and I sold my other collet chuck. And the collets that were with it, which were SAE, and these were metric.
Did Grizzly have them in Springfield?
I don't know.
I got mine through Witchcraft. I don't know either.
I got mine through Craft Supply.
Okay.
And I waited until I had it. They had a sale, and that's when I did it.
No, well, the deal in
college, but I bought them.
The PSI, the deal. You know, people say, "Oh, get a deal; it's better." Yeah. I can't tell the difference. I've had both of them.
What size do you need for just a standard like plank for pouring? Is that
Actually, a three-quarter won't work.
Three-quarter won't work.
And, but they've got, you can buy a separate, I have the SAE set, and I had to buy like a 20-fill 64 or something. They have one bigger than three-quarter.
They got a couple bigger, actually.
Do it. But that one works.
I've got a 13/16.
Okay.
And it's bigger. They also make a 21 millimeter that's outside the size of this set. It's bigger.
That's not anybody.
So, and I couldn't find the 21 on the bottom.
Will that slip in there?
Yes.
Yeah.
It should.
Because that's the first one you're gonna need.
No, it won't.
Mine is like a 25/64 to 23/64 or something.
Because I got, this is 13/16, this is even bigger than that. Huh, these, I don't know what PVC he used for that, because that's a bigger PVC. We'd have to ask David. Okay.
Should turn it down a little bit.
All right, so everybody wants to make a kitless pin. Let's say everybody does. What kind of kitless pin do you want to make?
Ebonite.
What kind of pin?
Fountain pen,
right?
Mm-hmm.
If you got your first car, not don't you answer this, but if you got your first car, you start out with a Corvette? I said, don't you answer that.
Chevy Chevette.
Okay.
That was my third car.
This was my first successful kitless. Actually, I've had a couple of successful before this one, but this is just a click pin. And this has been through the washer and dryer and everything, well, washer and dryer. And you can see it's kind of crooked because some of the threads broke off. It's PR. And all kinds of things wrong with this. It actually threaded. Actually, one of my kids, right behind you, see right there, right next to that duck call? This is actually my first kitless.
The knife.
Exacto knife. Because all I needed was to thread the cap. That's all I needed to do. I made it out of PR, and it really looks ugly now because it's got CA and PR and everything else all over it. But, I mean, I use it every day when I'm in the shop. I mean, all the time. And the cap broke about 3 days after I finished it because it was PR. So don't use PR unless you just want to play, in my opinion. This is also, I'll pass that around. It works just fine. You'll notice the nib, that is a cigar nib. You can buy cigar nibs at Wooden Whimsies, individually. And if you want to get into kitless and want to do them fairly fast, you want to do a quick pin or you can even, I've never made a Sierra type pin or a cigar type pin using the mechanism. I guess you can. That's just, it's never been something I wanted to do. I like click pins. See how smooth that is? And that, like I said, it's been through the washer and it's crooked and the threads have been broken a little bit, but it works. That one is easy, okay? Because you can glue in the nib. You really have to make, I think there's just one tap of dye you need for the mechanism. Mechanism is that thing on top. It's off, it threads in, you just unscrew it. Don't unscrew it because I'll never get it back on. Right on that one, because the thread's about broken. One thing I don't like about that one is how short it is. It's a short pin, in my opinion. I like
I've seen Sean bounce PR off.
Yeah, but he hasn't seen him bounce a one that's got a wall thickness of 1.5 millimeters. His are about 4 millimeters thick, some of those ones he makes.
Yeah, he's making some big pins.
He's definitely putting them out, too.
Yeah, he is.
Now, are you doing a lot of the stuff on metal lathe?
Yeah, but everything I do on this, it's easier on this, it's faster, it's more precise, but you can do everything on a wood lathe. That one you're looking at, I did on a wood lathe. In fact, several of them I've done on a wood lathe. Okay, I'm going to start another one around. This is one that is a click pen. It's 99% finished. This was going to be my button that I had never finished. It actually works. I'll pass it around. If you want to make it work, you just push it in and out. It's not glued in.
Button looks too big from here.
If you look at that closely, you can see there's a little brass tube because I have a cigar nib on that one. You can see the brass tube. Not very well, but you can see it.
That's like a kitless pin you'd make for a bank. That way nobody can steal it because you can't click it anymore. They keep the button behind them.
You about to say, just click it once, leave it out there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Give one of those little chains with all the little balls and pass it through the back end.
Yeah.
only screw down the ditch.
I'm gonna pass this one around, this one's not quite finished, but I like that pen so well, I thought, well, I'm gonna make it where it's not translucent, so I don't see all the stuff through it. Then I decided that, hey, I got a metal lathe, I might as well cut some metal, and I made an aluminum nib for it. So, aluminum's pretty, it's easy, but it scratches so easy. I've had this polished, and it's still, and now it has scratches on it, just from sitting in this little plastic container with some middle metal parts rolling around. But it's ready to go. I just got to finish the end of it and put that mechanism in.
I think this is threaded in here.
Now, how do you drill the aluminum?
This piece right here is threaded in.
You drill it just like you do wood.
But I mean, does it have to have a step inside of it for
yes.
the pin?
Yes. Oh. And basically, all I did was I took the nib that's on that one that's being passed around. I just kind of measured. I don't know exactly. I need to make some more notes and say exactly how I step drilled it. You can take that nib off if you want to.
So did you just try copying a cigar nib? Is that where you were going?
No, the reason I did it that way is because it should come off. Does it come off?
Yeah.
Okay. It doesn't, it's kind of hard to get back on, but it'll go on. You've got to get it lined up just perfect.
Don't want you to unscrew it. You can take it off, but it's hard to get back on.
No, that other one is hard to get back on.
This one?
Yes.
Well, that's what I was asking. Okay, this bottom piece here thread into this, or
yes.
is another piece?
No, that whole piece threads into that.
There, okay. Now, do you have another one of these mechanisms laying around?
I do.
Okay.
Awesome.
These are yours. They're working.
Okay. Anybody else want to look at this? Didn't get to? Wants to?
You drill it on the lathe?
I do drill on the lathe. And I put that on a collet chuck, and I do everything on a collet chuck. Now, you've got one of you that's kind of out of center?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, I drilled it on the lathe, but when I spun around, I made, you know, I took little small pieces, and like for the cap, I threaded the inside and outside of where I could screw it on, and used that, you know, if they were going to keep changing the chucks out, or my collets out, and it just ended up out around. I don't know how.
Well, I think I know what you're saying, and when you made that piece, you're talking about making a tool?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's talk about that for a second.
What do you lubricate your threads with?
I use turbine oil. And you turbine oil. Yeah. It's got paraffin in it. And
that's Zum oil, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
You can get it at Ace Hardware.
You can get it at some hardware stores.
What kind of oil is going over to Iraq?
He's Zoom is what he said. Zoom, right?
Zoom. Z-O-O-M.
Yeah.
Zoom.
Okay.
I borrowed that maybe out.
A Rushford?
No, it's a...
Or if you know somebody that's got an ag plane, well, anybody with a turbine engine on a plane, they use turbine oil. Zoom oil's cheaper. I mean, I couldn't believe how cheap it was. I'd never heard of it. So I just said, you need to use Zoom oil.
That's okay.
They use it for lubrication, heater motors, and that kind of stuff. It's got that long spout you pull out and squeeze it, and it.
You know,
same,
like I turned
I forgot
water.
$2 and something, it's cheap.
That out while
where
it was
you
still,
get, huh? Where you
after
get. Ace Hardware is where I found mine. I think there. Most Aces have it. I've never heard of it. It really surprised me. But it's really good.
Lubin electric motors.
It's too small.
I know Shopsmith uses it on their motors.
When you turn this, you ever have stuff on it.
It's hot.
When you start working on this, and when you put a piece in there, leave it in there as long as possible.
No.
Don't do anything else to it until you absolutely have to take it out. I mean, put all the threads on it, everything. So when you turn this piece to make your deal, did you turn the whole thing?
Yeah, we'll do the barrel.
Okay. But we'll talk about that in a minute.
Yeah. If I did the nib, it took me, I don't know, 4.5 hours just to do the section.
Yeah. And how many, just one? You only did one section?
Believe it or not, it came out first try.
You better
my second, third, fourth, and fifth.
You get the section demo.
No. Second, third, fourth, and fifth are somewhere in the back corner of the shop. Or this corner, I think one of them's out in the front yard. One of them I think I can get to the dog.
One thing you'll also get into, and you don't have to start this way, it makes things easier. You can make yourself, and you don't have to do it the way I did it. I made mine out of brass, but just because it's a little more sturdy, but you can do it out of Delrin or aluminum or, you know, alumilite. When that pin gets back, I'll show you. But this I made is I'll pass it around, it's just a little tool, but it's a basically a mandrel for me to turn my aluminum nib on, and
that's what I wanted. Yeah. Trying to make them to where I can just, you know, undo it, put it back in, tighten up the bill.
Just make sure when you do it, like that's made out of brass, make sure you true up the brass. Don't just put it in the collet chuck and make your mandrel. True up the brass, take it out, and put it in a smaller collet. Because that, it won't be, you think it's true, even though it came from a factory round, mm-hmm. It's not as round as it needs to be.
And if you don't put it back in the same place, it'll...
Now, that was the first mistake I made, is like, why is this thing not working? You broke my top.
Well, if it's aluminum, it won't break.
Aluminum will break. If
just cut it off and rethread it.
It was going to be anyway.
That's what
I'm by middle ways now.
No. I can make a little chair back here.
No. Yes, Lynn, yes.
No.
Yes.
It's got enough toys.
It's got a toy. It's
that's fair about her. The
a
wall
new metal lathe?
Back bedroom. That's a real serious.
How many times do you use that scroll saw?
Come on, tell everybody.
I'm going to get some more pictures from Joe.
Well, then you better drive over
to Joe's house.
I
need to.
Yeah.
Did you see those pictures?
I drilled it out first.
I drilled it out first.
Ready
to.
And then take it all right. And how that worked is basically when I put it in the...
We took pictures of the girl.
When I put it in the lathe, it doesn't matter which lathe you use. When you start, do not take it out. You never get it centered again exactly the same way. So what I did is I take it and I drilled it and tapped it, and I cut it down to the right size, basically. Then I finally took it off because I had to part it off because I can't get down to finish it off. So then I took that mandrel. Is that mandrel still going around?
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm going to make another mandrel. I did this one because I was afraid of the aluminum showing through the blind. So I threaded, I don't know if you guys saw it, but I threaded it this way. So when the nib's on there, there's nothing to show through. So it goes on like this, and it's too light. I'm going to make one out of stainless next. But anyway, that's, and it goes in the collet, and you just turn it, and you can shape it up with the wood turning tools. And I also also support it with the tailstock, so it's got that hole. Okay. So if you don't, you can aluminum, steel, whatever will flex a little bit. So use the tailstock.
How big is the hole in there?
I don't. It's big enough to where that goes through and doesn't bother me.
But you drilled that with what? The hole in it.
I don't know. I have to.
Okay, but you just took a drill bit.
Yes.
Put a hole.
Basically, what I did is I dripped a drill bit in the cigar nib.
But say one that fits in there.
One that fits in there, and that's what I use.
Okay.
And it's a letter bit, or a number bit, excuse me.
Yeah, number.
How did you get that close to the material? Did you get Rick to make another tool holder?
No, because I did it on the metal end.
Oh, well.
I got it, I might as well use it.
You're only going to have this much room between your collet and your tailstock. Okay. You're not going to be able to get anything in there.
That's another tool you need. A little bitty tool rest. Rick Harrell on IAP sells these, and you can buy them for a mini lathe, midi lathe, or a big lathe, and they all cost the same. They have the same price on these.
Yeah, 3-inch, 6-inch.
Yeah, and the post. I think he charges more for these posts now, but he didn't used to.
Post, yeah.
The big post costs a little bit more.
You tell them what kind of lathe.
Pass that around.
Is that threaded on there?
Yes, you can change them out. You can.
It's like Best Tools out of Tennessee makes the two-part rest. Post and stuff.
Yes. Yeah, you can get different rest on there.
Yeah.
And I've got there's one right here.
So that solves the problem of being able to get to the collet and not having your tool rest as far away from whatever. The only tool rest I have.
Yeah, there you go. That's what I'd think it's for.
What, driving a little
else? Hammer.
That's when he does his shoes.
Okay. When you start getting into taps and dies, what you want to do is you want to pick a style of pen you want to start with. If you want to start with a fountain pen, that's fine. But you're going to run into a minimum of probably three sets of taps and dies, depending on what you do. But what I do is these are what I use just to test stuff with. And I got a lot of scrap aluminum light. If somebody wants some scrap aluminum light, let me know and I'll save you some. Next meeting, you can have plenty. But when I make a piece, I test it with that to make sure it's threaded right.
you using metric or standard?
And I only use metric.
Metric.
And I'll talk about that in just a second, why I do that. Metric is, I'll talk about it now. Metric is really easy because they have a diameter and a thread pitch, like a 10.7 × 0.75. 10 millimeters round, 0.75 millimeters thread pitch. What's the depth of the thread? So the thread is going to go in 0.75 millimeters into the material, okay, but in both directions, half and side. Okay? So when you drill a hole, you want it to be how big?
9.25.
Okay, easy. Just take off the amount of the, actually it'd be about 9.3, but there's all kinds of charts. You want a little bit of play.
Excuse me.
That's some of that Common Core math.
The answer is perfect. I know, that's perfect math, but it's not the perfect world because if you're using aluminite or most of our materials, they flex. So when you're drilling it and pull it out and when you thread it, you're not going to, the threads will not be 0.75 in there. You'll find that out once you do what Scott did and say, how come this is so freaking tight?
Yeah, you can't get it to go in there.
That's right.
I need perfect. A VAG chart for this.
Okay, so when you do the tenon, what size tenon do you do? No,
10.
Because it's going, you're cutting off that.
Oh.
Okay, everybody understand that? So if you have a 10, let's do like 0.5. You have a 10 times 0.5. Okay, so the hole needs to be 9.5 roughly, actually probably 9.6 would be good. The tenon needs to be about 10 or 9.95, somewhere around there. You need to have a little bit of play. Metal, if you're doing steel, then you can be exact, but if you're doing even aluminum, they say to give it a little bit of play. I didn't know that on aluminum, that's what I read. I can't prove that, it's just what I read.
We should have gotten an easy.
Those threads are all perfect.
Huh?
Those are perfect.
Of course they are.
You wouldn't expect anything less, would you?
Here, look at this one if you want to see the perfect threads.
Let me get you one that I made.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, I can show you some imperfect threads.
I've got all kinds of imperfect threads, I promise you.
If you wanted to do that, I'd be better off doing it creating. I don't know how I'm going to create.
Those are just tools and you want to line things up. There's another reason for that, and I had one and I lost it. Tell you how often I use it. But when you're drilling, what you want to do is, let's say you're going to make a barrel. And we're actually going to do this, but we're not going to do it today because there's just so much talk about on getting started. It's all this meeting is going to be about today is getting started and kickless. Okay, but when you drill the barrel, you thread it first, then you drill it. Okay? And the reason for that is if you drill it first and cut the threads, you're going to break that off. Okay? So you drill it, or you thread it and drill it. Well, even when you drill it, you can break that off. So what a lot of people do, which I recommend, is you take a round piece or about that size, tap it all the way through, and screw it on to your threads. That gives your threads some support. So when you drill it, there's less chance of them breaking.
Where are you buying your tips from?
I buy mine from Tool Machinery. They got a $25, I think it's $25, it used to be $25, I haven't bought it in a while. But, and also when you do that, you're gonna need taps and dies. That's what we're talking about, how we make the threads. Do everybody know what tap and die is? Okay. Anybody wanna see one that doesn't know?
Yes. I like to see, do they differ from automotive and hardware store tap and die?
Taper and bottom?
Some of them have, these are 1-inch dies. Some of them are larger, some of them are hex, I think, or, you know, you can pass that around.
Are they bottom taps?
That's what I was going to get into. You can buy bottom taps, you can buy taper taps, you can buy, what's the other one? There's three kinds. Bottom,
plug.
That's just a regular die.
I thought there was three.
Starter, plug, and bottom.
Okay.
Which we're making outside.
I did not buy bottom taps. I recommend you buy a bottom tap every time you buy a tap and die set. What that does is it takes the very, it basically is not tapered. So once you have your threads cut, what you do is you thread it, you cut the last threads with it, and what that does, the threads kind of taper. In fact, the thing that you guys pass around that tightens up, when you notice when you get to the end, it gets tight, there's a taper. They're slightly tapered.
And that's made from what tap? Bottom?
A bottom tap. Bottom solves tap. That problem. I didn't show the taps today.
the bottom tap solves that problem.
This is a taper tap.
You said the bottom tap solves that problem to keep it from tightening.
Well, what it does, it cuts that taper out at the end. It's there's no taper to it. This is a taper tap.
It'll thread all the way to the bottom.
Okay.
Can you see that?
And it cuts.
Yeah, that works fine. All that is just a tool that I use to make sure my threads are good. It's 9.75. That's all that is.
It's just a tester.
You're able to buy that Harbor Freight, but they don't sell it there anymore. You used to be able to buy that Harbor Freight, but they don't sell it there anymore.
The one for Schmidt feet?
I don't know what Schmidt uses, so I don't know when I got it home.
Okay. Other tools you'll need, recover taps and dies.
Are there like 4 or 5 standard sizes that fit, that make most pins, or do you have to have a wide variety?
It's more of a question of taste. Like Sean, I wish he was here, because he loves to make these big pins. They're 14 millimeter.
Body's a 14, yeah. Caps are 16.
No.
Caps are huge.
Well, yeah, the outside of it. Yeah, they're 16 around, but he uses a 14 millimeter tap and die for that. That's like this. You know, they're huge. They're not that big, but they're big. They're probably...
You can hold a bottle of it.
Yeah. 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 But his wall thickness is very big.
How big?
I'd say it's probably close to that big. I wish I had the one I did my wife, because I did it with a big nib, but I made it as thin as possible. And 12 is about as small as I could make it. But I used a big nib. But if I made it a number 5, nibs come in number 5 and number 6 generally. There's all kinds of sizes. Those are the ones I know. I don't know everything there is about kitless. If Sean was here, he's a wealth of knowledge. He custom grinds nibs. He can do those flex nibs out of gold. You know, somebody sends him a $100 nib, he charges him $50 to do it, or whatever he charges. Basically, on this tap, or the only difference between this tap and a bottom tap is if you take to a grinder and grind off all the taper, you got a bottom tap. That's basically the difference. Okay, but I recommend you get those. Okay, because one, you won't worry about how far you need to go in. You go in as far as you need to. Do the second tap, get all the threads clean, and you won't have that tightening up like this one has. This one's got oil on it, so it runs a little smoother than it should, but it actually is a little tighter than it actually feels.
And what's that tap? Say that one.
This was a 9 × 0.75. I like the 0.75, especially for a wood lathe that gives you a little more play. Metal lathe, you can do the 0.5 to get a little, they're finer. But when you're working on a wood lathe, I wouldn't go any finer than 0.75. That's me personally. Because you're trying to take off such a fine amount of material. And next time we do this, the plan is that we'll do like the body. We'll do the body next time. And then or the section, whichever one. Whenever Sean comes, we're doing the section. Because he's going to do the section. But then I'll do the body, or somebody else can do the body, and then the cap, and we'll basically show how we do that. But I want to suggest that you guys start. There's a great tutorial on IAP doing a kitless clip. Like that first one I passed around. Easy, one thread, one tap. You can use a... He may use two, because he made it on his own nib. I just use a cigar nib. It's simple. I mean, there's nothing to it. You just take a 10 millimeter piece of brass tube, use the whole thing, part of it. I use part of it because I bought the long ones. So I just use whatever I needed. Put the nib in, you're good to go.
Who did the IAP tutorial?
Who did it?
Yeah.
I think it was by Hans. Oh, I think his name's Hans, but it's not his IAP name.
Yeah.
Where do you find the cigar nib?
Wooden Whims is where I got mine. Other places may sell them, I don't know.
How do you know what thread size?
It'll tell you on the let's talk about that. The mechanism that I used in that comes from Richard Greenwald. Does anybody know the name of his website? I'll find it, and I'll email it out. I'll do an email after this, and I'll email it to everybody. And I'll give you all the links that I've been talking about, like Get the Machinery or whatever. And a lot of you guys know them, but if you don't, it'll be in that email.
Now, you could do a pen out of aluminum instead of these cast products, right?
Yep. But if I'm going to do aluminum pen, I would make sure it's brushed, because if you do a polished one like that nib I did, I would be, is it around or is it, anyway, it doesn't matter. Oh, here it is right here. I don't even care if I lose it, because I'm not real happy with it, but anything scratches aluminum. It scratches so easy. So it's going to look bad in about 2 months. Don't give it to your wife and have her put it in her purse.
Yeah.
That's really all I have on kitless today. I know that probably not as much as you guys wanted to see, but breaking it in parts, I think, gives everybody a chance to make some sense out of it. I would suggest that you think about getting a couple things and trying it before the next meeting. And
so what would you suggest we do first?
I'd suggest you do a kitless click. It's easy, doesn't cost you a lot to get into it. Other than if you got, especially if you already have the collets.
Yeah.
And I use collets for everything. I mean everything. I don't know how you guys square blanks, but I use a collet. I put my round them, I insert my tubes, I put it in the collet, and I just chase the ends. And that's how I square my blanks. It's on the lathe, it can't get any squarer than that. And I never had a problem. I've never torn one out or chipped one out. Of course, I say that next time I show you that will happen. But that's what I did. You can trim off grass if you need to with it that way. And I take my parting tool and I kind of just put it on the inside and I just kind of use it to finish off the inside of the grass so things slip in easy at the end. And it's right on the lathe, easy to do.
Can you get by with a three-jaw chuck?
People do it. Sean started with a metal lathe, a three-jaw chuck, and that's what he did.
Until you buy your collet.
Yeah, you can. I wouldn't want to, but you can. The thing to remember, when you put it in there, don't take it out till you're sure you're done with it. You know, the first time I did it, I put it in and out, and if you rolled it on the table, it looked boom, 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 boom. Just roll like it's going over a bumpy road.
Even in a collet.
Well, it's because I kept taking it in and out.
Oh, wow.
So, you learn the sequence of things, and, you know, the barrel's the easiest thing to do, so I'd start with the barrel. There's basically, you have to thread it on the outside, tap it on the inside for the section, and after that, you shape it.
For one of these click pins, basically, you have to thread both ends of the tube, and you got
a
pin?
Yeah, basically. I mean, there's a little more to it than that. Like, this one, I don't know, this is used as a different kind of mechanism than the other one. If you guys take this apart, anybody take this apart?
Mm-hmm. Does the clip come with the...
No, there's no kit.
No, the clip.
No, there's no kit. You buy
a
clip.
So you buy the mechanism, and then you have to buy a clip?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or you make one out of it.
Well, people make their own clips. I've never...
Make them out of paper clips. Make them out of anything.
Welding rod.
Yeah. The easiest way is to go to penparts.com.
Penparts.com. Richard Greenwald sells some clips. Yeah.
Are you going to email us a list of all this stuff?
I am.
Greenwald?
Okay. Yep. I will make email everything.
That's invaluable for me.
Then you're going to come up to the house and help us?
No. You can come down here. We might do that. That'd be fun. I had a kitless. I think I sent everybody one.
We were hoping Dave and I were going to come down, and I don't remember something happened. I wasn't able to make it.
Dave did come down.
Yeah, and I wasn't able to make it.
Yeah, we were here, and we were doing a kitless click, and in fact, we did one. We basically followed the instructions, except we did it basically like this one with the cigar nib.
Yeah.
And we used the outside mechanism, not the inside mechanism.
If you do a fountain pen, you just buy the thing that holds the nib?
No, that's the section.
Yeah.
No,
you can buy a section.
You can buy them. You can buy them. Churchill.
Churchill's one.
There's two names.
El Grande,
yeah.
Yes.
Or you can just take a nib from a fountain pen kit that you've got.
Well, you got to have the right threads on it.
You have to see what threads.
And they're not common threads.
Of course not.
In fact, some of them nowadays have got square threads on them. You know, I don't know where you get
that. Like the Sedonas are like 9 or 8 by
0.37 or something.
Yeah, some weird number.
You're not going to be able to get it unless you spend a bunch of money.
The section is just the thing that the nib slips into?
The nib has a feed. The feed feeds the ink.
Right.
Okay, usually,
that's the slotted thing under the nib.
Right. When you buy it,
when you put this email out, will you do like a parts list of the pen? You know, this is the nib, this is the section. Because I have no clue what a section is.
Okay.
This is a section. Okay.
That's the part that's holding.
Yes.
That holds the feed and it holds the net.
So some of these things are terms I don't know what they are.
Okay. And that's why I talked about buying a Pinto or a Corvette to start driving with. You know, it's a lot easier to start with something that everybody already knows about. You can make a fountain pen, you can make a ballpoint pen. You can make any kind of pen. A lot of people make ballpoint pens, but put a cap on it so they don't have to have the mechanism. So there's no twist or anything else, just a ballpoint pen.
That's a good idea.
So you have to make your section the nib.
You have to yes, sort of. I mean, there's you can use the you can you have to make it fit the section, but you also have to make it fit the size pin you're gonna make. And I wish I knew where my wife's pin was. I can find it. I just don't have time to look for it now. But they come in all different sizes, and it's just whatever your imagination and physical limitations. And we're gonna talk one more thing about kitless before we get done. I want to talk to you about when you make your barrel, okay, you're going to have a feed in it or a section in it. And you're going to have a cap threads on top of it. So usually your section threads are right inside the cap threads, traditionally. People make them different. Some people make it where the cap threads are further up. There's different ways of making it. But in all practical purposes, they're going to be on top of one another. So when you've got we'll use 10 millimeter for this easy. 10 by 0.5. When you cut your threads out and you want to have a 1 millimeter difference in there, meaning that the threads that are on the inside are 1 millimeter from the threads on the outside, okay, you got to think about this, okay, because when you cut the outside threads, you're going to cut off how much? You got 10 millimeter tenon. You cut it and you're going to go into half a millimeter. How much, how thick do you have to worry about? What?
Two.
No. Because you're cutting in a half millimeter all the way around.
It's going to be a 9.5.
No.
To the inside of your threads.
No, it's not. It's going to be 9. You're taking off a half a millimeter from this side and a half a millimeter from this side.
How big is it on the outside?
No, but you got to care about the inside.
Right. But if you cut this 10 and you cut a half out, that's 9.5 to the bottom of your threads.
Not, if you measure from the bottom of both sides, it's
but
9.
You said 9. I said the outside.
If you do the outside of the bottom of the threads, it's 9 instead of 9.5. Because you've got a half a millimeter on each side.
Each side.
That's just like taking half a piece out of a bowl.
Yeah, but you still have a half a millimeter wall thickness on the front part of the bottom of the thread to the inside of the barrel.
You wouldn't be able to run a 9 millimeter drill bit.
No, you wouldn't be able to run a 9 millimeter drill bit.
You'd end up with a lot of little rings.
Mm-hmm. Because you wouldn't be, you're not, when you think about this, you're taking off 0.5 from each side or all the way around on every side.
So what you're saying, this is very good.
Mm-hmm. You're taking off twice what you think you are.
What's your wall?
Well, I mean, that's something you got to decide.
Yeah. Well, that's what I mean, your wall set. If you're gonna put a thread on the inside, you could.
So what? So if you know you're taking off 0.5 on each side, what's gonna be the largest inside diameter you could have?
8, 10, 9,
basically. Not well. You could go right up to 9 before you cut threads. Okay, because you're
so dang. Sean told me to skip one.
Yeah, you're right. It would break.
That's either 8 and 10 or. 10 and 12.
But these are usually 0.75. I did 0.5 because it's just easier math.
Yeah, those are 0.75.
Yeah, these are 0.75, and most of them are 0.8 or 0.75. The inside threads might be 8 times 0.75. Okay.
This has got to be.
I've done them 1.5.
Yeah.
The one I did for my wife, that I did it as thin as I possibly could with a 6 nib, was about 1.5. And long story short, she's not a pen person. She wanted a fountain pen. Every time I go to use her pen, it was dried up because she never used it. So I kept cleaning it. And every time I go back to it, it'd be dried up again. So I cleaned it and put the ink in it, and she never did it.
But she's got a pretty pen.
She got a pretty pen.
And it's clean.
And it's clean. She'll come to me one of these days, this isn't right.
Are there ends available for rollerball for the pen parts?
Oh, yeah.
.com?
Yeah, there's pen parts may or may not. There's can't remember. There's one place to buy them. I've never bought them because you can make your own, but and a lot of people do. I'll have to see if I can find it. I've never bought one, but I know they're out there. Oh, I know a place that has them. There's a place that makes a, you can use the same mechanism, but it's, I'll have to look it up. I can't remember. But I'll put it in the email. I'll do a little research about it. And there's a couple places you can do it. There's also a place that you can buy a cartridge, roller cartridge mechanism.
It's a roller rider.
It's
the same thread as this, except it uses a cartridge, but it's a
roller ball. Yeah, it uses an ink fountain pen cartridge, but it looks like a roller ball. Mm-hmm. And they don't last very long. So,
all the ink come off.
Well, I don't know. I used one for a while and I quit working. And I just quit. I said, I'm not doing this again.
Wouldn't be good for a left-handed person, then.
Probably not.
Probably you'd have the ink drug all over everything.
Depends on the ink. Now, there's a lot of people that say if you get the right fountain pen ink, that's not an issue. I'm right-handed. I don't care.
I use fast dry because I'm less going.
I can't use a gel eraser because I smear on
all your blanks, poly resin.
You know, I love the way they write, but these are terrible because my hand runs through it.
I have some aluminum light. If anybody wants to try some, I've probably got some that I can give away just to give a sample or two. Oh, there's some aluminum there. There's at least these are. I know you can use these. I don't know. I'm going to have to ask him where he gets his PVC because that's bigger than ours.
Maybe the seat PVC.
Bob, if you're done, I'm not trying to rush you. I was just going to ask Ken if he would tell the story about Alyssa.
Alyssa Welch up at the hospital. She was turning a pine bowl, probably less than 6 inches in diameter. Said she just took her face shield off. The tendon broke off the bottom of it. I don't know if it bounced off her head first, but I assume it hit her straight in the eyes first. She's wearing some kind of plastic safety glasses. The doctor, when she finally decided to go to the hospital, said if she hadn't been wearing safety glasses, she would have crushed this bone right here.
Wow.
But she was hit in the head, broke her nose, took 30 minutes to get the blood to stop. She didn't go to the doctor. A couple days later, she fell out trying to get in the car to go to church, and her husband insisted she go to the hospital. She had a severe concussion and whiplash.
Wow.
She just got a new machine, and a beginner, and wasn't wearing that safety shield. So I think she learned a lesson, and it's a lesson she'd want to share with you all. Don't do it without her face.
There was a guy at SWAT who was turning these little, he would go, little knots on trees. He'd cut them off and make little small bowls out of them. He says, I've never had one break.
Bang.
Flew halfway across the room.
Yeah. And she had two shiners, the prettiest shiners you've ever seen for 2 weeks, and a lump on her nose. And the doctor said, you want the lump on your nose or do you want to be able to breathe? That was her choice, fix the lump and not be able to breathe through your nose or live with a lump. So now she still has a permanent lump on her nose. But it was severely broken. Thanks for reminding me. That's a lesson.
Well, that's something everybody needs to hear.
Yeah, it really does
it's
happen.
It's possible.
Yeah, it really happens.
It's easy to take it for granted. It's not going to happen to me because I hadn't done it before, like you said.
Yeah, a lot of people, I mean, we've been guilty of it, doing these little turning things, and we're only turning a pin blank. How bad could it be? I had a peaceful out, had glasses on, hit my ear, and my ear was bleeding. Yeah, I mean, that hurt. Felt like a bee sting went whap. Back when I was bad, I don't ever chip anymore.
Or your nose is growing, Bob.
Yeah, that's right. Anybody have any questions about kitless so far? Next time we'll plan on doing a barrel or section. So when Sean's here, we'll do a section. He'll bring a bunch of them to show. And of course, everybody will bring one to show next time, right?
Yeah.
I got one later. I'll come over.
If I can get them in from the south end.
Scott, you recorded this, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Where will we see this? Where can we see this? Because I'd like to go back and look at this.
Oh, I got to edit it. I'm sure.
Send that information through him, too, or something.
Send it to me. I'll make sure it gets out.
I'll have to put it on YouTube because the file will be so big, I won't be able to email it.
You can put a link on the Facebook page, too, right?
Right. I don't know how big of a file I can put on Facebook.
You can put a big file.
Yeah, this thing's been running for 40 minutes.
I can't find
it. Use handbrake.
Yeah. For the YouTube. Yeah, or I could upload it straight to Facebook.
No, just put a link to it.
Just put a link to it on YouTube and find it.
Yeah.
On the upload.
It'd be easier.
What is the Facebook account under?
There's a Woodturners, there's an Arkansas.
Well, he put up one specifically for us.
I'm trying to remember what I called it.
Yeah, don't ask me because I am not a Facebook person. I go there once a month if I have to.
I think it's Central Arkansas Woodturners Club or something like that. I can't remember. Okay.
Central Arkansas Woodturners is group out of Hot Springs.
Yeah.
But you still have it. He may have called the Facebook page that too.
No,
oh, you mean they called theirs that one?
Yeah, that's the Hot Springs Club.
Mom, what do you use?
Arkansas Pen Turners and more?
I use mine just about everything except metal. Actually, I did that piece of aluminum on there, and that's why it's black.
So Arkansas Pen Turners and
I'm getting ready to buy me a new set of wheels, and that was going to be my metal one. And I'll have another one.
Arkansas Pen Turners and more.
Or CA. But that makes polishing so much easier.
You do that instead of micromesh?
No, I use micromesh the first 5 ads, and then I use that.
Well, see, I think Tony L. and Maddie's name, he had his muffin system he set up, you know, what he did. I think he said he didn't use micromesh anymore.
Some people don't.
I don't like
with too.
When this micromesh is gone, I'm not using it anymore. There's 3M makes a sandpaper that goes up to the same grit is micromesh, 8,000 grit, I think. That's what it goes up to, right?
Well, 12.
But anyway, it's going to go far enough for me to go to the buffing rooms.
I know. Yeah. Got one that goes to 5,000 now.
So there's one that goes to 8,000.
Oh, what about Vincent Welch and the sanding?
I don't know what you're talking about.
There's nobody sander bowls with the little, what do they call those sanders? They're not powered. You put it up there.
Oh, the air ones?
No, it's
just in pneumatic.
You mean the friction? It just spins. It just spins.
Nobody uses that.
I have a couple, but I don't ever use them anymore. I've made them.
Do you just sand with random orbit? Is that what you use on?
Either that or I put it on my drill.
Little drill.
Yeah. I bought a little Ryobi just for that.
That's what I bought.
Shorter head.
I don't know, it's the Ryobi.
And I make my disc, and I can just buy one.
I was going to buy one of those little angled Velcro ones.
So I go to Walmart and buy the Velcro.
I bought it.
It's got a quarter inch bolt.
It's
a mouse pad.
There's a lot of air.
That's what I'm afraid of. That's why it was just going to be the very finest, very finishing.
What do you hollow out the bottom of your bowls with down deep?
What bowls? Chini bowls?
Bob, I'm talking to everybody.
Yeah, good.
I hauled mine out with a remesh.
Yeah, we saw that.
It's already finished. I saw that big round carbide he's got. Would that work all right?
Yes,
it would. The big round carbide you have?
I guess it would. I mean, I've used that sparingly. I've been watching a lot of videos. I'm going to learn how to use real tools. I'm going to use carbide.
Cheaters.
One more thing I want to show. Has anybody seen these? If you want to make your own tool handles, you can make one tool handle, you buy these for like $12. You got to buy an insert for whatever kind of tool you're using, and then you make an interchangeable handle. Now, I'm going to do this for bowl gouges, because then I can simply take my bowl gouge out, I can sharpen 3 at a time.
Tape bond.
You put that in the wood, that's more of a purchase bar to
get it. I think it's tape bond too.
Change them out in no time.
Yeah, if the glue don't break, they'll put the glue on.
You probably saw that. It's a lot.
Well, it's always easy to find it, too. It's always
just a big part. That's probably part of the answer.
I bet I got a pile of them.
You've got a bunch of wood already. already made up for it.